Hello everyone, and welcome to this online talk of the BSDCan. It is about the sysctl of FreeBSD. I'm Alfonso Siciliano, a FreeBSD contributor and a FreeBSD laptop user. I'll describe sysctl info, an interface to explore the sysctl management information base for getting the info of an object. So, the sysctl system call is a prerequisite. Sysctl can get to set the state of the system, for example, to set the max number of sockets without recompiling the kernel, or to get the current number of the opened sockets. The kernel exposes a parameter for sysctl as an object of a management information base. Each object has a number, so an object ID is a series of integers separated by full stops. This is a good notation for the kernel namespace. This slide shows some well-known objects in the FreeBSD kernel. An object has also a name. It is better for us humans. Above, some read-only objects to know the current version of the system. Bottom, some read-table objects to set the networking. Like for the sockets, we can set a property of the system without recompiling the kernel. The value of an object can be an int, a string, and so on. Sysctl is fully documented in the third section of the manual. Briefly, the first and the second arguments represent the OID. They are an int array and an unsigned int. It makes sense. Indeed, an OID is a series of integers, and we need a variable to know its levels. ID level should be between 1 and the sysctl max name constant. Now it is set to 24. Sysctl fills all the pbuffer with the value of the object. If it is null, only its side will be set. If new p is not null, it will be the new value of the object, while all the p will be filled with the old value. Here, an example to get the value of an object, in this case the host name. Let's see at the sysctl call. The first argument is the OID. It is a well-known OID, so it is defined by constants. The second argument is a 2, 1, full stop 1, are two levels. The third argument is the buffer. Sysctl will fill out it with the value of the host name. The fourth argument is the size of the buffer before the calls. After the calls, sysctl will set it with the size of the host name. The last arguments are null and zero, so sysctl won't set a new value. Let's say in this case the value of the host name is fbsd.laptop at the bottom of the slide. And now an example to show how to set a new value, again the host name. And again, let's see at the sysctl call. Now, the last arguments are not null and zero, but are the value of the new host name and its size. You can see the old and the new value at the bottom of the slide. The MIB is implemented by a collection of trees. Every node is a row, is an entry of a simple list, and every node represents an object. So, an object is implemented as a node of a tree. This is the definition of a node. It is in sys/sysctl/page. In red, the number of the object ID. Of course, sysctl is implemented in the kernel, properly in kern_sysctl/c. Sysctl visits the MIB to find an object by its OID. Then it calls its handler. Finally, the handler can read the new buffer or write the old buffer. Here, you read the handler in the definition of a sysctl node. FreeBSD provides also a sysctl utility. It wraps the system call. Both have the same name. The utility is documented in section 8 of the manual. With the AA option, sysctl shows every object. Nowadays, the MIB has thousands of objects. Really, sysctl doesn't show the internal nodes, only the leaves. I'll describe the reason later. Sysctl can print only one object by its name, its value, its description, its type. Of course, the manual describes all the options. Sysctl is not the only tool to explore the MIB. This is a fairly new utility. It can print the label of an object. Let's go back to the MIB. It is in the kernel. How can the sysctl utility print the MIB in the userland? The input of the system call is an object ID, but the input of the utility is a name. The system call finds an object by its ID, then calls its handler, so the description, the type, and the label remain inside the kernel. The kernel provides an undocumented interface for getting the info of a node, name, type, format, next leaf, the ID by the name, description, and the label. The interface is implemented by sysctl nodes. Sometimes they are called internal nodes, magical nodes, or undocumented nodes. The handler explores the MIB to find the wanted object, then pass the info to userland via the buffer, exactly like every node. This is the current documentation. It is a comment in kern_sysctl.c. Recently, the magical numbers have been replaced by constants, but they are still present in the code. Here, the six nodes of the interface. They are in the third subtree of the MIB. Their names describe their purpose clearly. Except the name to ID, the nodes of the interface are CTL type nodes with a not null handler, so their ID is extended to specify the ID of the wanted node. Here an example to get the description of an object. The memory copy function extends the ID with the ID of the wanted object. Sysctl finds the 05 object, and the ID of the wanted object is the input for its handler. The handler finds the wanted object and fills the whole buffer with the description of the wanted object. The sysctl utility has a similar code. Name to ID is different. Its handler reads the new buffer in green to know the name of the wanted node. Then it finds it in the MIB and fills the whole buffer with its ID. Sysctl9 is the kernel interface to add or to remove an object to the MIB. Currently, the max level of an object is set to 24. So, we can add an object with 24 levels, like that in this slide, and the sysctl system call can get or set its value. Except num2id, the nodes of the current interface can manage a node up to ctl max nameless 2 levels. Let's see at the sysctl call. The problem is red. Let's say we want to know the description of the previous object. It has 24 levels, so 24 plus 2, 26. So, correctly, sysctl returns less 1, an error. This example is similar to the code of the sysctl utility. Indeed, this slide shows the fault of the utility. It is a false negative. Let's see at the last error message. The utility wants to know the type of the object to print it properly, but the current interface cannot manage an object with 24 levels. Of course, any tool on this interface has the same problems. The interface provides the sysctl next node to explore the MIB. It gets only the next leaf. They are in green in the example at the button. Indeed, the sysctl utility only shows the leaves with a option. Sysctl view is a graphical MIB explorer. It needs to know also the internal nodes. A feature to get internal nodes could be useful. Of course, sysctl view could be a client. Sysctl full stop name gets the name of an object by its ID. A use case is the sysctl utility with the A option. Sysctl full stop next gets the next ID. Then sysctl full stop name gets its name, so the utility can print the name of the object of the MIB. The utility manages only real nodes. If no node has the OID, sysctl name returns always 0, building a fake name. It could make sense with the last example, because 141 is a node with a not null handler. However, it is just a case, because sysctl name doesn't check the type of the object. A feature to build on real names can be useful. Some client could be the sysctl MIB info library and every library on this interface. The sysctl system call shares the manual page with another system call, sysctl by name. Sysctl by name accepts a string name to specify an object. Then the manual tells. Apart from that, it behaves the same as the sysctl. It is false. The manual page uses the can proc pid object like an example for sysctl. But sysctl by name cannot manage it. Sysctl by name uses sysctl full stop name to OID to get the OID of a node. But this node of the interface cannot manage an extended name with the input for the handler of an object. Moreover, name2OID finishes to search an OID if a level name is just a null character. So, sysctl by name could return a false negative. Now, an example with the sysctl utility and name2OID. This is a real object in the FreeBSD MIB. It has a description, a type, and so on. But its name has just a null character. The utility displays its value at the last line. But it shows also the brothers, because name2ID returns the ID of the parent. It is not printed because it is not readable. The current interface does the check if an object has the CTL capability flags, so it returns error information about the node, also in capability mode. Finally, the interface is quite inefficient. The kernel needs to find many times the same object to pass all its properties to userland. The current interface doesn't meet my needs, so I wrote sysctl info. The main requirement is the last, libraries, tools, wrappers in Python, Haskell, and so on, use the current interface, so both interfaces have to coexist. Luckily, it is an easy task, because the interfaces are read-only. Sysctl info provides a new set of nodes corresponding to the current interface to manage an object up to CTL max name levels. Here, the sysctl utility converted to use sysctl info. It can handle an object up to 24 levels. The new entry next node can get the next leaf and the next internal node. It is possible to show subtree of CTL nodes. I added a new feature to get the OID of a node also without a level name. It is entry ID by name. Above, the sysctl utility converted to use this feature. It shows only the wanted object. Another new feature. This node can manage also a name extended with an input for the handler. It checks if the object is a sysctl type node with a not null handler, otherwise an error is returned. This feature can improve the sysctl by name. The example at the bottom of the slide shows an object in the FreeBSD MIB. So far, sysctl info can pass only one property at a time, so the kernel needs to find the same object many times. These nodes address the problem. They find the object, serialize it, and pass all the info in one time. Moreover, the new by name nodes can find an object by its name, avoiding to explore the MIB just to find the corresponding OID. Sysctl info supports the capability mode. After a keep enter call, no information about a node are passed to user space if the node has not the capability read or write flag. This table is a comparison between the interfaces. I didn't describe enter name. It builds the name of an object if it exists, otherwise it returns an error. Sysctl info provides two macros to get the info of an object. The first, sysctl info, finds the object by its OID. The second, sysctl info by name, finds an object by its name. Then they are equivalent. The macros hide the special nodes of the interface to the developer, and using the macros, it is obvious that we want the property of an object, not its value. Let's start with the sysctl info. The first and the second arguments represent the OID. They are an int array and a variable to know the levels of the ID. Of course, sysctl info can manage an object up to sysctl max name levels. The third argument specifies the wanted property. It can be the name, the description, the label, or all properties. It should be set by constants. The macro fills this buffer with the wanted information. The last argument is the size of the buffer before the call. It will be set with the size of the info after the call. Now, sysctl info by name. The first argument is the name of the wanted object. The second argument specifies the wanted property. And finally, the buffer to get the information. Both macros return less one with an error, and the global error variable is set like the current error code. Here, an example to get the description of an object by its name. It is obvious I want the description of an object, not its value. Indeed, I added these macros while I was converting the sysctl utility. Sysctl info is documented by two manual pages, one in the fourth section to describe the sysctl nodes, and another in the third section to describe the macros. Also, a README file is available. It has an introduction, implementation notes, API, and FAQ. Each feature has a little description, an example, its constant, and possible errors. Here, an example to get the label of an object. Finally, there are examples in the public domain for getting started projects to explore the MIB. The core of sysctl info is just a function. It implements all of the nodes. Sysctl info can be in a module or can be merged with the kernel. The MIB is a critical section. No node can be added or deleted while sysctl info or the current interface explore it. So, to avoid a kernel panic, both interfaces have to use a lock. By name nodes are almost code-free. The function finds the object matching the name, not the number. Some node does the check the capability flags for compatibility with the current interface or for allowing to explore the MIB. Of course, I can add capability if someone needs it. Everyone can use sysctl info by installing its port. The node to improve sysctl by name is in another port. Sysctl view is a well-known client of sysctl info. This mixer uses sysctl info to show the objects of the sound driver and the object of a device. The nsysctl utility is a clone of sysctl with extra options and libxo. Here an example with libxo. And using these options, it is possible to debug without recompiling the kernel for using 00 sysctl full stop debug. The sysctl MIB info tool library wraps the sysctl macros to provide some handy and easy API. Moreover, it provides a high-level API to build data structures of objects, for example, a list, a tree, and so on. At its core, sysctl view is just a call to sysctl mif underscore mip. The page of this talk on bsdcan.org shows every link about this presentation. The presentation is ended. Thank you to watch it.